probably should have said this before, but again, disclaimer, like, pretty racist in this book and sexism throughout, and towards the end it gets to be like mentioning how it's pretty homophobic too, you know, because it needs, anyways, you'll figure it out. I believe too the birth earth will leave in its wake tens of millions of unhappy adults who, through no real choice of their own, will end up with no children at all or fewer children they really wanted or many fewer grandchildren than they had hoped for. Measures I adore the thought, adhor the thought. I believe it is possible that, because of the changing ethnic and racial balances that come with the birth dearth, we may face some increased divisiveness and turmoil in America, which could have been avoided had the birth dearth not visited us now. I believe further, perhaps, most importantly, that the birth dearth may well turn out to be the great harm to the broadest value we treasure. It will make it difficult to promote and defend liberty in the Western nations and the rest of the modernizing world. I do not mean to sound apocalyptic, but the demographic forces now in motion may just yield a world, one in which we or our children will live where the U.S. will no longer be, quote, the most important country in the world. It could be a world where the alliances of Western nations will no longer shape either the political agenda, the cultural, or the direction of the global economy. This, I believe, could not only harm the Americans or our Western allies, it would also harm all other nations and peoples of the world, certainly in the poor areas of the globe, and quite possibly even among the Soviets and the Soviet bloc. Again, didn't the Soviet Union fall or something? Now, I don't mean to sound dumb, I haven't done research on this, but that's just the last thing I thought I heard. We have lived through an era of free-falling fertility in the modern demographic world. The key question it yields may well be in this. Over time, will Western values prevail? It is true that almost since the advent of the free Western modern world, and that dates back several centuries, its future has been questioned. It has been asked, could the capitalist countries continue to prosper in the face of internal economic contradictions? Were these free nations with democratic politics made of stern enough stuff to stand up to external threats from totalitarian states? Would they doom themselves to death by pollution or death by environmental degradation? We've managed. Those who have predicted Western demise have been wrong so far. So far. It repeats that too. I'm sorry I keep laughing at some of the stuff that he says. Like, I just kind of relish in his fear, because it's just so, I don't know. The way people talk about racism sometimes, and the way people, like, they panic, it's just, I know it's a serious problem, and I'll be harmed by their panic eventually. Like, once it stops being about race and starts being about other things that they want to remove. But, seriously, I don't know, I get a kick out of it sometimes. It's just so, like, look how much this dude is panicking. Watch him dance. I'm sorry. I'm trying to be respectful here. Okay. We do not know the future, but if the dim outlines of the world we see through the lens of demography are any measure of what's to come, it may well be a world we don't like. We may face a situation where our birth rate, our legacy, and our prosperity are diluted. It says diluted three times. Perhaps even to the point where they gradually cease to be relevant. Curiously, while it's happening, we may not even be aware of it. That is perhaps the most pernicious and baffling part of our situation. The nature of the harmful aspects of the changes ahead of our way hardly be noticeable as they occur. they will progress slowly at first, then gain speed. But at any given moment, things will probably seem to be just the way things are, or ought to be. For history is a one-way street. We usually don't understand in the present what might have been had we acted differently in the past. Suppose, for one example, and this is twisted what he wrote here. Suppose, for example, that the U.S. had legislated a restrictive immigration bill in 1824 instead of 1924. Under such a circumstance today, we might be a nation with a population somewhat less half of our current population, almost as populous as Japan. Would the world be different? I surely believe so. Would we be a superpower? Perhaps, but I'm dubious. Would the U.S. have had the capacity to embark on a space program and fly to the moon? Could we support the armed forces necessary to deter potential Soviet expansionism? At best, all this would be much more difficult. In any event, would we know what might have been? Surely not. Or suppose, in 1930s, that we, England and France, had made a decision to stop Hitler before he got started, avoiding World War II. Could anyone today know or understand the magnitude of something that never happened, or 60 million people who were not killed? Of course not. After the fact, we don't know what would have been, or what could have, we don't know what could have been. So the reason I find that really weird is because, like, he sort of mentions Hitler in weird ways throughout, but it's just like, couldn't we have just befriended? And I know he didn't say that, but it's like, you know, instead of having immigration, couldn't we have just stopped Hitler instead? It's like, what the fuck? Alright, maybe I read that wrong, but that's really strange to me. Like, I get what he's saying. Anyways, I confess, I offer this slender volume with trepidation. In many ways, it goes against my grain. Through my writings and television work, I have become known as an optimist. I would maintain, of course, that I am only a realist. But the words follow me. Optimist, Pangloisian, roseate, Dr. Feelgood. But whatever the description, the truth is that I do indeed believe that in my adult lifetime, our modern democratic society has worked out remarkably well. I was born in 1933. I was 12 when World War II happened. I believe we in the most free, most prosperous circumstances the world has ever seen. And for now, it's still getting better. I think this progress almost surely will go on for at least a short while, until fairly recently. I could divine no particular likely reason why our world would not continue to flourish well into the foreseeable future. At root, it is clear that the marriage of liberty and technology is powerful medicine for what ails people. So why am I, of all people, writing this alarmist tract? I only have one sad answer. I am alarmed. The situation I describe here scares the hell out of me, and I am convinced it is real. I do not believe I have fallen victim to projectionitis, that disease of straight-lining trends into the future until they become absurd. I know full well that a projection isn't a prediction. But recall this. Although there have been some notable blips in the line, fertility has been falling in most of the Western world for more than a century. That is not exactly a short-term trend. It was tacitly presumed by many demographers that the fertility drop would stop when it reached replacement level of about 2.1 births per woman, because if it didn't, the species wouldn't survive. Considering this is just so obsessed with white people, he's referring to the whole species depending on white people and the Western nations. Or he means something worse, which is just like, you know, he's dehumanizing people by saying we are the rest of the world and nothing else matters, I guess. I really get that out of some nationalistic talk. Anyways, but that's not what happened. The rate went lower. Most of what follows in this book is speculation about what happens if the rate in the democratic industrial societies stay just about where they are now for another generation, or two, or three. It is not about what happens if the fertility downtrend continues and the rates go even lower, even though the latest rates for the modern world as a whole do show the decline continuing. The difference between projecting leveling off or the low rates that already exist and have existed for quite a while, which is essentially what I do here, and projecting a continuing downward slope is a difference with a great distinction. Now, that still doesn't mean things can't change. They may indeed change, or up or down. If fertility rates go lower than they are now, the consequences will be more dire than described here. If by chance the rates should turn solidly up in the years to come, the reader is invited to throw away this book. Much of it will be relevant. The speculation here is usually about what happens if birth rates stay roughly where they are in the modern parts of the world. It can be noted, then, that in two of these three possible scenarios, the two most plausible to most experts, the speculations offered here are based on projections that would at least support the numerical basis for such a pessimism that as found in here. The time, okay.